Electric motors play a very important role in our everyday business lives. They move and run basically everything we need for business or pleasure. All these motors run on electricity. To do their job of providing torque and speed, they require a certain amount of electric energy. All of these motors use electricity to provide the required torque or speed. There is a method for controlling these motors that not only saves energy, but also reduces scrap and maintenance costs. It's a type of technology known as an AC drive. So, what exactly is an AC drive? Our AC drives are also known as variable speed drives, VSD, or variable frequency drives, VFD. How do AC drives work? Our drives are installed between the electrical supply and the electric motor. Power from the electrical supply goes into the drive, and the drive then regulates the power that is fed to the motor. So, let's try to explain the working principle of a variable frequency drive. The three phases are fed into the VFD and are connected to the rectifier. The rectifier is made up of multiple diodes that are connected in parallel. Diodes allow electricity to flow in one direction only and block it from returning in the opposite direction. We can control the path that the alternating current can take as it flows forwards and backwards, giving us a rough direct current output. The rough DC electricity now flows into the second component, the DC bus. DC bus is the filter that smooths out the rectified DC voltage with capacitors and/or inductors. The purpose of DC bus is to produce a clean, smooth, constant DC voltage. This is accomplished by releasing electrons during the gaps in order to smooth out the ripple. The new smooth DC then flows into the final section, which is the inverter. We covered the working principle of a power inverter in one of my previous videos. The link is above. The inverter consists of a number of electronic switches, known as IGBTs. The controller opens and closes these IGBTs in pairs to control the flow of electricity. By controlling the path which electricity takes and how long it flows in the different paths, we can produce AC electricity from a DC source. Let's take a closer look at that now. We will look at the rectifier, which is the first component of the VFD. The rectifier contains six diodes connected in parallel, which we will label from 1 to 6 as follows. Each of the three phases is connected to a different pair of diodes. As we all know, electricity must return to its source in order to complete the circuit. So, in this configuration, the current will flow through the load and back to the source via another phase. Remember, this is possible because the current in each phase flows forwards and backwards at a different time. The load can be anything, a lamp, a motor, or an entire circuit. In this case, the load will represent the rest of our VFD circuit. The electricity will continue to alternate in supply phases, but the diodes will only let the peak phase to pass, blocking the others. So I'll just animate this peak phase. Let's look at this animation. In phase 1, alternating current enters and can only flow in one direction, which is through diode 1, and then passes through the load. Once the current passes through the load, it must return to the source. And because phase 2 is in the negative half of its cycle, the current will flow through diode 6 into phase 2. In the next segment, alternating current is still flowing in phase 1, through diode 1, then passes through the load. Once the current passes through the load, it must return to the source. But now, phase 3 is in its negative half. So, the current flow returns through this phase via diode 2. In the next segment, phase 2 is approaching its peak, so the current now flows through this phase and through diode 3. It then flows through the load and back into phase 3 via diode 2. In the next segment, the current flow is still in phase 2 and passes diode 3. It then flows through the load and back. Phase 1 is now at its negative peak, so the current will flow through diode 4 back into phase 1. In the next segment, we see that phase 3 is now approaching its positive peak, so the current flows through this phase via diode 5, then flows through the load, and then returns via diode 4 into phase 1, which is at its negative peak. Finally, the current flows through phase 3 via diode 5, through the load, and then back into phase 2, which is at its negative peak, via diode 6. This cycle just repeats constantly like this. If we take a look at an oscilloscope for the three-phase supply, we'll see three sine waves for the AC electricity, but the oscilloscope on the load will see this as a rough DC electricity with some ripples in it. Now, we need to smooth out those ripples to clean up the DC electricity. For this, we connect a capacitor between the positive and the negative side of the circuit. This capacitor acts like a storage tank, absorbing electrons when there is an excess, and injecting electrons when there is a decrease in electrons. This will therefore smooth out the ripples in the DC electricity to a nice smooth signal on the oscilloscope. I have covered the capacitor in one of my previous videos. The link for that is above. Now we have clean DC, and we're ready to turn that back into precisely controlled AC at variable frequency drive. And for that, we need an inverter. An inverter is basically a number of IGBTs, which are switches that can be turned on and off super fast. We're going to animate this using some simple switches instead of IGBTs, just to make it easier to visualize. Switches are marked as follows. To get our three phases, we must open and close switches in pairs to guide the flow of electricity from our source to a return path, so that the attached motor receives alternating current. Remember that alternating current reverses direction. So, if we take a lamp and connected it to some switches and a DC power source, supply, we can regulate the direction of current through the lamp by opening and closing switches in the right order, resulting in the lamp experiencing alternating current, even if it is supplied by a DC source. For the three-phase supply, we open and close switches to simulate the three phases. Let's see how this works. First of all, we close switches 1 and 6. This will give us phase 1 to phase 2. Then we close switches 1 and 2. This will give us phase 1 to phase 3. Then we close switches 3 and 2. This will give us phase 2 and phase 3. Then we close switches 3 and 4. That will give us phase 2 and phase 1. Then we close switches 5 and 4. And this will give us phase 3 and phase 1. Finally, we close switches 5 and 6, and this will give us phase 3 and phase 2. This cycle repeats again, again, and again. So, if we check this with the oscilloscope, we now have a pattern that looks like an AC sine wave, although it's just a little bit square. This will work fine for some applications, but not all. So, how can we improve this? Do you remember earlier in the video, we mentioned that we can open and close the switches at different speeds and durations to change the waveform? Well, we can do that with this too. What we do is to use a controller to rapidly open and close the switches, multiple times per cycle, in a pulsating pattern, each pulse varying in width. This is known as pulse width modulation. The cycle is broken up into multiple smaller segments. Each segment has a total amount of current that could flow, but by rapidly pulsating the switches, we control the amount of flow occurring per segment. This will result in an average current per segment. We can see that this increases and decreases, giving us a wave pattern. The load therefore experiences a sine wave. The more segments we have, the closer we will imitate a sine wave. We can control the output voltage by controlling how long the switches are closed for. So, we could, for example, have an output of 240 volts. Or 120 volts, just by trimming the opening and closing times of the switches. We can control the frequency by controlling the timing of the switches. So, we could, for example, have an output of 60 Hz, 50 Hz, or 30 Hz, whatever is needed for the application. Remember, by controlling the frequency, we control the rotational speed of the motor. So, coming back to our VFD circuit, we're going to use the controller to rapidly open and close the switches in order to adjust the output frequency and voltage. So, by combining the rectifier, filter, and inverter, we get our variable frequency drive, which is used to change the speed of electrical motors and unleash energy savings in a variety of systems. Let's summarize this learning about the variable frequency driver. Inside the drive, the input power is run through a rectifier that converts the incoming AC power to DC power. The DC power is fed into capacitors inside the drive. This is done to smooth out the electrical waveform, which provides a clean power supply for the next step. Power then flows from the capacitors to an inverter. Inverter changes the DC power to the output AC power that goes into the motor. This step allows the drive to adjust the frequency and voltage that is supplied to the motor based on your current process demands. This means that you run your AC motors at the speed or with the torque according to the demand needed. This is why you can save large amounts of money using AC drives. Now that we have an understanding of how a variable frequency drive works, let's see what they are used for. One very common use in industry is to control the speed of a water pump in a water treatment facility. A water treatment plant typically has a constant flow of water coming into the plant. However, if the water demand exiting the plant is lower than the supply entering the plant, then the operator will need to slow down the supply. This is achieved by using a VFD on the AC motor. The operator can monitor water flow and manually adjust the VFD accordingly. Another great thing about VFDs is the fact that they can be controlled with a PLC. Using basic communication protocols such as RS-232 and RS-485, PLC can monitor and control motor speeds using the VFD. This makes a process, like water purification, easier and more efficient. This system may be utilized in any case where automation would be beneficial. Okay guys, that's it for this video. If you have any questions, please leave them below in the comments section. Don't forget to subscribe, like and share this video, and also watch the rest of my videos from my YouTube channel. Please also consider supporting me on Patreon. Thanks very much. See you on the next video.